you just got into this construction world, right? You've been in it for about a year, and like you're with the, what's the, I would call field verified, and the people that I know there, like first in class, top tier people, top tier leadership, top tier culture. Like you ain't playing with the scrubs over there. Now that you've been there just over a year, what do you think? Like, if you let your imagination run on you, what do you think is ahead of you?
I think about this from time to time, honestly. Yeah? My first few months, I'm just over here trying to eat. I'm just like, yo, I'm just trying to get my feet on the ground. What's caulking? What's that again? That's the ceiling? Okay, yeah, I'm there, right? But as the fifth month came, the sixth month came, I started feeling a little bit more comfortable, getting my feet down on like the position I was doing. And then I started to see, oh, and we started being able to go out with consultants and do some like job shadowing, doing some shadowing with a consultant. We call the sneaky consultant, where we go out with the consultants, see what they do. And so I started getting like, oh man, I like waterproofing. Like, I think the whole waterproofing thing's cool. Like below grade, waterproof period, but low grade stuff was the first thing I went to see. And I thought, man, this is really cool. I can see how this can be messed up. And I can how important it is for the whole structure of the building. So now I start to realize things. So just as I started to realize that, I'm like, man, this is cool.
That strange voice you heard is Mr. Rolando. We have an amazing conversation. If you can't tell in that first 90 seconds or so, the energy and the charisma that that man has in his voice, I'm here to tell you it's real. And once the YouTube, the video version of this interview releases, you can see it on the YouTube if we don't fry all the interwebs with all the charisma that he and I bring to the conversation. Along with the charisma, we talk about relationships or the value in building relationships through treating people respectfully. We also somehow end up on like one of my favorite subjects, which is discovering the way you best serve. And so Rolando dropped that and I hopped all over it. We get, you know me, I get a little wonky sometimes. Also got to let you guys know that this interview with Rolando is going to be the last one for 2022. The reason for that is because I've taken on some projects and maybe overestimated my capabilities. I'm working on my second book, which is going to be titled Learnings and Missteps, My Path to Discovering the Promise I'm Intended to Be. So keep an eye out for some more updates as I go working through that, because y'all just know how much I love the editing process. And I've got to finish processing the conversations I've had with Thomas LeMay on our collabo sessions on the go. I still have a few episodes to go there. And if you haven't listened to one, you just need to know those things. There's a lot of content. Almost every single one of them is 2 hours long, and just packed with really deep, meaningful, responsible conversations. So keep an eye out for those. There's three out right now, and there's several more to come. We will be back in 2023. Never fear, we're not giving it up. We're just kind of reprioritizing some things because business is good for me. So I also got to go out and earn a living. And speaking of earning a living, want to give a shout out to our patrons for all of their contributions. You're probably listening to this episode right now and appreciate that. But if you jump on the YouTube, man, you can see my slick lights in the back. They look like lightsabers. So it's some of the gear, little upgrades that we're able to make, little tweaks to provide a more engaging experience for all of the L&M family. So patrons, I appreciate y'all very much for all your support. And for the rest of the L&M family, love y'all. The holidays are coming. Be good to your people. Be good to yourself. And here we go. Back to Rolando. What's going on, L&M family? Here we are with our... I feel like we're like primos. Like we've been connected for years. What do you think, Rolando?
Hey, I felt the same way. Even just connecting with you on LinkedIn before I even heard your voice. Then seeing your videos and being able to connect in person as if we knew each other from around the way.
Yeah, man. The post I remember you had, it was a video or something you created about the L in caulk or caulking. C-A-U-L-K. That's the one, right?
Yeah, that's the one. When I first got into construction, I'm relatively new. I've heard of sealant. Like I know what that's the, but it was like caulking. I'm like, what's that? And then when they told me, I was like, oh, sealant. Like, yeah, it's just a word for it. And then I've heard it was like, oh, caulking. So right when I heard it, I was like, yo, what's that? Oh, it's caulking with L. I was like, oh, and I've heard people say it in different ways. I'm like, what is it? Like, how do people really say caulking or say caulking? It just comes out, it just flows out the mouth. And then we decided to make a little thing on there. And I put a little Spanglish in there to make it funny. I tie myself in there.
So. Oh, yeah. But heck yeah, man. So you're in Arizona, correct?
Yes, sir.
How long have you been in Arizona?
I moved out here. I was a college baseball coach previously, so I moved around a lot. My first stint in Arizona was back in 2018, 2019 school year. Once that school year ended, I ended up getting a different opportunity out in Texas, so I moved there.
Yeah.
But as far as Arizona, I've been here since Memorial Day weekend of 2020. So
what's okay.
Just so over 2 years now. So yeah, creeping into my third year, consecutive year here.
I got a little bit of the scoop when you and I were chilling there at that icebreaker event at Field Verified. So like I got a little bit of behind the scenes information in terms of the way you entered the construction industry.
Yeah.
So man, can you like help the people out there understand just the background? You said you're a college baseball coach.
Yeah.
So that makes me assume that you played baseball maybe in high school. Tell us a little bit more about you, big dog.
Oh yeah, I was a ball player. I was a ball player, so definitely that was what helped me get my foot into the coaching at the college level. Played high school ball. Grew up playing baseball. I was a baseball family. Come from a mixed Latino background. Mom's Mexican, dad's Puerto Rican and Cuban. Yeah, grew up in Chula Vista, California, just south of San Diego, right there on the frontera, Tijuana, San Diego.
Okay.
Yeah, so played baseball on both sides of the border. I was in the States on Saturday, played baseball on Sunday in Tijuana. So,
nice.
So yeah, baseball was been a huge part of my life, still is. Matter of fact, there's a club ball team I coached. I got practice later on after this.
Oh, okay.
But yeah, baseball's been everything. So I got to play college baseball in South Dakota and in Iowa, Dakota Wesleyan University, and then Clark University in Dubuque, Iowa. That's where I graduated from. Had a little taste of independent ball, signed a couple contracts. And I had some missteps that took along the way there too. Looking back on, I'm like, man, I could have done X, Y, and Z and I would have progressed in that realm. But so definitely a lot of learning along the way, but baseball always been a passion of mine. And I come from a bigger city, you can say. Sometimes there's not as many opportunities to certain folks. So sure. A lot of times exposure came about. I didn't really have a direction going when I was going to college. Nobody advised me on scholarships, how I can negotiate my scholarships with the coach. I didn't know any of this stuff. I was the first to do it in my family. So for me, the passion for coaching at the college level and helping and getting in the coaching world after playing ball was to help kids like me. So I started coaching high school baseball. Didn't know after baseball, I didn't know what I wanted to do. There was a lot of realms. People were like, oh, you'd be good in this, you'd be good in that. Your personality, you can do this, you can do that. I'm just like, I don't want to do that. I don't want to do this and I don't want to do that. But I knew I wanted to help out, and education was always something that I loved and I had a passion for. So education and coaching go hand in hand. As I realized getting into different industries, it's still the same thing. And coaching, it's the same thing. It's just on how you, it's just how you word it. I guess not getting too far of bouncing back and forth, but even getting the construction industry, it's helped me because I was a coach, because I was an educator, like stuff kind of helps me out a little bit, learning things in the process we go. But going back to that, so I got into working in high schools. I was a substitute teacher. The cool substitute teacher.
I was just going to say, come on, tell me you were the cool one.
But yeah, I did a little subbing and I worked as a paraprofessional as well. I was like an instructional aide for classes and special education. Yep. Had a couple different positions. And then I had the opportunity I went to an alumni event back in Iowa at my alma mater. One of my buddies was getting married. I went back there, met a couple people like in the admin realms of Clark University. And one guy was like, hey, Rolando, started talking to me. He said, man, you ever thought about coming back and working here? And I was never in my life. I told myself, I'm never going to Iowa. But here I am in my mid-20s and I'm like, you know what? Yeah. And he's like, hey, keep in touch with me. Creating relationships, right?
Yeah, boy. Oh, yeah.
And a few months later, I reached out to the guy. He said, hey, there's an admissions counselor position opening I think you'd be perfect for. And when it came up, I applied for it. And I was very involved in my school in college. Playing, being an athlete, being a student athlete, I was involved a lot. So, and the lively personality you see me have, of course, like, I make friends with anybody. Right away, people who worked there when I got recruited, and then obviously I went there and did what I did, they were like, we'd love to have Rolando back. So it was like no brainer. And I got extended an offer, and I was coaching high school baseball, working back home, helping kids get to college, play college ball, make decisions on where they should go. And then I felt myself, you know what? I think I can even do more up here. And I started, worked as an admissions counselor, was coaching college ball, my alma mater, and then right away got a coaching opportunity for a really big collegiate summer ball team in Alaska. So 2-3 months out of the year, but at the time I wasn't really making much. And they're like, hey, we're going to give you like $6,000 for 10 weeks. And I'm like, to coach baseball?
Let's go.
So I was like, I can't be an admissions counselor full time and coach baseball in the summer. So I took that leap. You know what? I'm going to do this. This is going to get me some other position. And sure enough, like I went and did that. Went to a grad school in North Carolina. I didn't really do all my research, but I just knew, hey, they were paying for school, they were paying for this, they were paying for that. I'm like, they got a room, I got food, and I'm doing baseball and in school. I'm
it's
out.
Good.
And it ended up just not being a really good situation. Misstep right there was like, I didn't do my research. I had a buddy that lived 20 minutes away, one of my best friends in life. He's still my best friend to this day. He lived 20 minutes away. He's like, man, you could stay here on the weekends. And I'm like, yeah, just because he lived out there and it was an opportunity, I just went. I didn't do anything what I needed to do my research on. And it bit me, but that's when I got my first opportunity back here in Arizona, here in Arizona the first time. So I bounced around. I lived in Iowa, was in North Carolina for a short time, moved here to Arizona. And then after my second summer coaching in Alaska, one of my ball players, mi hermanito Giancarlo Servin, he put me on with his coach at the college that he was at, Texas A&M Kingsville, Coach Gonzalez.
Yeah, baby.
And I got the opportunity. I talked to Coach Gonzalez. I was like, hey, I've already been a recruiting coordinator. I've been an assistant coach. And he's looking at me like, you're going to take a step back, right? You're not really going to have a pool like you used to in your positions. And I'm like, hey, you're a legendary coach. Yeah. I want to learn. And sure enough, it ended up being the COVID year. So season gets started, 22 games in. We're on our way to Lubbock from Kingsville. Yeah. We're like two exits away, and we get a phone call from NCAA saying the season's canceled.
Turn around.
8-hour drive. I'm like, Texas is big. I know why they say you don't leave Texas, because you can move completely the other side of the state, and you're still in Texas.
So, yes, sir.
Like 2 days away from everybody you knew before. We're still in Texas. But yeah, so I ended up out there, and then I got an opportunity back with the same coach that the coach that got me out here the first time at Benedictine University Mesa, Coach Brian McCabe. He was one of my college teammates back in Dubuque, Iowa.
Okay.
We always kept in touch. He was still one of my good buddies. And when he had the opportunity, got the job, he called me. I was in North Carolina. That's what brought me out here. And coming back around, they got me an admissions job. So I was able to come back, and that's how I started my life here. And then was doing that for a couple of years. Took a scouting tournament director job for a baseball organization, and left my university job and everything I felt comfortable doing to take that leap again. Like, I want to get into scouting now. I did high school, I did college. I want to get into pro baseball.
Yeah.
And I took this leap because it was going to be the bridge to the next thing. And 2 months in, the guy's like, hey, I'm going to have to lay you off. I didn't really do my numbers right, X, Y, and Z. I just can't pay you. And I'm like, and at this time, I was already with my fiance now, but my girlfriend at the time, and we was already like moving that way. And I'm like, I don't got a full-time job no more. And first thing I thought of was, I'm going to coach club baseball because it makes some money. And there's so much out here in Arizona. Called my buddy, Jesse Lopez.
Yeah.
He was like, hey man, come through our facility and we'll talk baseball. And I'm like, I go there. And I'm like, hey man, I just got laid off. So I was like, hey, I'm looking to coach. And he's like, yeah, that's cool. We could talk about that later. Man, what do you do for regular work? And I was like, I'm done. It's a college baseball coach. I've done everything. Landscaping, worked at Pizza Hut, worked at Bojangles in North Carolina, like up that.
Hey, Bojangles is for real, bro.
Fuego, Bobby. Fuego. Oh, yeah. Breakfast, I take that breakfast over any fast food joint.
Dude. What are the potato patties or whatever it is?
Brisket
with the chicken.
Dude. I was the biscuit guy, Jesse. No, I whipped it up in the morning. Winston-Salem, North Carolina. Your boy was whipping up biscuits at 4 a.m. Yeah, that was me.
That's why I like you. Now I know.
Yeah, I do anything. Growing up, my pops did a lot of different side jobs and different work. He worked for a flooring company, but he was a mechanic. He did this, that,
yep,
anything. So he was just a utility man and a jack of all trades, you must say. So for me, it was always like, hey, whatever you got to do to make the ends meet, you know what I mean? And so for me, I never was without a job. Like anytime I needed some, I was working. Job here, two jobs here, three jobs, whatever. In college, I had to work three part-time, whatever it was.
You got to make it happen. You got to make it happen, yeah.
So now here I am, now I'm life. And before it was like, man, it was just me the whole time. I didn't have to worry about nobody else. Mm-hmm. I got a couch to sleep on, whatever, I'm good. Now I'm like, man, I've got this life I'm trying to have. And so right away he was like, hey man, I work in construction. Our company, we do consulting. We're a building envelope company, which at the time I was like, I don't know what the hell that is.
What does that mean? Yes.
Yeah, it's a construction. We do consulting. We have this. We do all these different testing. And I'm like, man, I don't know nothing about that. So right away, I'm like, yeah, I'm good. What else can I do? He's like, no, man, like, really, I think he's just like, hey, you're not an asshole. Right. Excuse me, my bad. I don't know if I can curse on.
You're good.
I was like, he's like, let me introduce you to my boss. You're good people, man. He's like, they're good people. He's like, I think you should come and really see what we're about before you defer me. And I'm like, all right, man. And at this point, I'm like, yeah, who am I to be deferring anything? If you're hungry, you give me a piece of bread, I'm going to eat a piece of bread.
You're going to eat or not?
But instead, I didn't get like a piece of bread. I got like this just gourmet out the oven type bread. When I came here with Phil Verified, I got to come here and meet Brian Melcher, my boss, Riley O'Neill, who's the director of our testing.
Okay.
And I got to meet the whole team. And right away, I felt really comfortable and it was really cool. I went on a job site with them for 6 hours, seeing what they did. And I'm like, I'm looking around, like, yo, this is what we do. Like, I can do this.
Yeah.
I can learn this. And we went to lunch afterwards. And at the end of the day, they're like, they're looking for the right person who's going to fit with the company. We could teach you everything else. Like, you've got so much to bring to the table. Like, you don't even know, like, how you're going to pick up. That was it. Next thing, a couple weeks later, I get a job offer. And it was cool because I told my lady, too. I said, hey, babe, I was all brave. I said, hey, babe, I'm going to get on my feet. I got this. Don't even worry about it. But deep down inside, I'm like,
what the hell?
What am I going to do? And but it goes back to relationships that I created, that we met.
Yeah.
And how I met Jesse was the first tournament I worked for, that tournament company I got laid off for. How ironic. I worked part-time for them since I got here in Memorial weekend, the Memorial Day 2020. So about, I want to say July of 20, the East Valley here in Phoenix, the parks were still open.
Yeah.
So they were still doing whatever. It was almost like COVID didn't exist. We have a tournament and I see this tall, big man, big, hey, gente, Mexican. I'm like, I got to say what's up to this guy. So I went up, hey man, I'm the site director, XYZ, blase, blase. Oh yeah, he's from Norwalk. So he's from SoCal, he's from LA.
Okay.
So we start vibing. And that was it. We created a relationship and he was in a lot of our tournaments. So I would see him over there and just BS with him. And here he is like already being like, yo, I know you good peoples. I see how you move. And I'm like, this is why I don't recommend nobody for jobs. So it really said a lot to, okay, I must be doing something right. The relationships I create.
Yeah. Yeah.
So,
yeah.
That's how my journey came about. And that was last October. I believe it was September, like it was right after my birthday. So I want to say it was like September 22nd or something. I got told I was being laid off at the end of October. And I was like, okay. And I got a job and I started my first day before the end of October with Phil Verified. So that's how I got into construction. So almost a year in construction I've been.
Yeah. Yeah, man. So a few things. One of the really interesting things is like all the people I talked to, all the guests that we've had on here, very few of them were like, yeah, I'm going to go do construction when I get out of high school, when I get out of college. Most of us had this really awesome windy road of getting into construction and then find out like, man, this fits. This is going to be good.
Yeah.
But a couple of the things that you said that I think are really important for people to understand, whether they're choosing a career in the trades or not, relationships and your personality, right? Like, you clearly were able to say, well, let me give this a shot. this might be the next step. And then, oh, well, Alaska and then North Carolina and then Kingsville and then Arizona. So when I talk about personality, I'm talking about like resilience and courage and enthusiasm to go out and do that and to say, baby, it's going to be good. I got this. And say, Tim, I don't know what to do. Like inside, it's not that easy. It's not as easy as you make it look. And then the value of treating people with respect. Just like I said, when we opened up, you and I met face to face there at the office. It was like there was nobody else there. You and I were just catching up. Like we hadn't seen each other in years. And that's like the currency that only increases in value. But once you use it irresponsibly, you never get it back. And so for those folks out there, the L&M family members, like especially the little squinklies, the little youngsters, like, no, you ain't got to be a fool, man. Just be cool. And it can transform your life. Oh, man. Okay, so baseball, I'm assuming you wanted to be a professional baseball player, just wanted to be in the baseball scene your whole life. And you went down that path, ended up getting connected with Field Verified. They're testing building envelopes, inspections of quality, making sure there's no finding leaks, repairing leaks, I'm assuming also.
We mostly find them. We usually the trade on site will repair, do any repairs, but we do the investigating. Most of the testing we do, a lot of the projects we're on, we are the consultants as well. So we got it.
So y'all are like the CSI of construction. Y'all out there doing your forensic investigations to find the leaks.
Yeah, it's fun. It's fun. Granted, we're with them. We want them to pass just as much as they do. We don't want, don't get what I'm about to say twisted, but it's when we see it, it's okay. Where is it coming from? That is where it's fun. Early on, I'm sitting there with a flashlight. Like, you see that? And I'm like, no, I don't. I don't know what we're looking at. But eventually, you start seeing this and you start seeing little things that come about. I'm like, all right, it's leaking from this top. And the investigating we do with the 501-2s and we have our little hose wand. And so we can start narrowing down areas, tape off areas, things like that. So it's just, it's sometimes extensive, but it's really cool. It's really cool because at the end of the day, we can help them. And now, the installers, wow, they had never dealt with that issue or whatever. So it's just really cool. So yeah, you said
the CSI of construction, boy. So thinking about like this, the windy path you had, I mean, granted, it was all in baseball and that's still a big part of your life. Plotting it out on the map, right? California, North Carolina, Alaska, Kingsville, Arizona, and you've grown. You made some really important relationships along the way that pay dividends for you in terms of career and earning. And now you just got into this construction world, right? You've been in it for about a year and like you're with I would call Field Verified and the people that I know there, like first in class, top tier people, top tier leadership, top tier culture, like, You ain't playing with the scrubs over there. Now that you've been there just over a year, what do you think? Like, if you let your imagination run on you, what do you think is ahead of you?
I think about this from time to time, honestly. Yeah? My first few months, I'm just over here trying to eat. I'm just like, yo, I'm just trying to get my feet on the ground. What's caulking? What's that again? That's a ceiling? Okay, yeah, I'm there, right? But as the fifth month came, the 6 month came, I started feeling a little bit more comfortable, getting my feet down on like the position I was doing. And then I started to see, we started being able to go out with consultants and do some like job shadowing, doing some shadowing with the consultant. We call the sneaky consultant where we go out with the consultants, see what they do. And so I started getting like, oh man, I like waterproofing. Like, I think the whole waterproofing thing's cool, like below grade, waterproof period, but low grade stuff was the first thing I went to see. And I thought, man, this is really cool. I can see how this can be messed up. And I can how important it is for the whole structure of the building. So now I start to realize things. So just as I started to realize that, I'm like, man, this is cool. And that's one of the next steps here in our company, like to be a part of, to be in the consulting. And it's another pathway. And
okay.
So like, man, like, I think this is what I want to do too. started learning different things and started meeting different people from different trades and different industries, and being able to be on different sites all the time. Being a tester, we get to go on. I've been a part of, I forgot what we talked about the other day, like 50, 60 different projects or something in a year. And that's just because this is the places we've tested. And so for me, that's like wild, because there's a guy that's been working in construction for 2 years and he's been on the same project the whole time. He might go get, he might have to go and do something else somewhere else, but like, yeah, this, I spend most of my time here. And it's like, oh, that's crazy. Whereas we get to see different things all the time. So as far as when I close my eyes and see, like, I'm still starting to understand everything, but I definitely, I see myself with Feel Verified, and I see the growth we're doing and we're having, and I'm part of it. And I think that's really cool. And we're continuing to evolve as a company. So I've even seen the change we've had in here for the last year.
Wow. Yeah.
It's great. So as far as like, where do I think I will end up? Like, honestly, Jesse, yo no sé. I just know, you know what I mean? Yeah. I'm going to continue moving forward and moving up. Where's that going? I don't know, but that's where I see myself continuing to go, though.
Oh, man. And here's the thing. Like, you're surrounding yourself with amazing people. So, of course, it's going to be forward and up, right? Like, you surround yourself, you show up right, you show out right, you surround yourself with good people, you apply yourself, you learn, and it's not a matter of what you're going to do. It's what you're going to choose, because you're going to have a tingles of options to choose from.
Yeah. But
that's just the way it works. And then again, like your personality, like you got all these extra special little gifts that I think that set you up perfectly to serve others just as well. Because I imagine you're coaching select ball, but you're not doing it so you can say you're winning games. You're doing it to pour it into all these other young men and women about what you know about life. Am I right?
100%. Yeah. 100%, man. 100%. That's you. I would have thought you've known me for years, Jesse, honestly. But that's exactly why I do it. And till now, like, I'm out of coaching college baseball, but I have so many different connections, and I still help a lot of kids go there, or guys looking to transfer that I recruited at a school, whatever. Like, I'm here to help them, because at the end of the day, I tell them, I say, hey, it's your career, Poppy. Like, I'm just a page in your book, bro. Like, that's I'm it. Just trying to make sure that you turn the page to the next chapter.
That's so it.
That's why I got into coaching, why I got into education, and just learning so much about how college works and realizing that you don't have to go to college. That's why I'm glad and I love the route I've taken, but I definitely have a lot more. Even getting into this industry now, I have a whole different, not that I had a bad look on construction, period. I have plenty of my boys from back home. One of my cousins, she's a construction worker. Like, I've had plenty of people work construction. I just never saw myself going that route, because I've always been focused on other things. And the fact that I got into this, I'm like, man, it's a whole new world. Like, it's so much to this, bro. So
does it surprise you, like, how much stuff happens on these big old commercial jobs?
Yeah. And some of these places, I'm just like, man, and there's just so many. There's a job for over here. There's a job for this. Like, in this room alone, there's 7 trades. I'm like,
oh, yeah,
it's crazy. That's what I thought was like the craziest thing. But yes, going back to the education part, it's continuing to help. Because I started coaching high school baseball back in the school district I grew up in. I moved back home to do that and to do that stuff. And I did that for a few years, and then took it to the next level, and then realized, you know what? I don't even know if this is the best way I can serve kids. Now, coming back coaching club ball, I'm like, now I can navigate. So now I went to the college level. I know how all the college works. I know admissions. I know what you need, all the different scholarships I wish I applied for. My mama did tell me she would always be on me about them. She would.
You didn't listen.
I didn't listen. Okay. So I'm not going to sit here and say I had no, when it came to that realm, I'm not going to say I didn't know anything about it. I didn't know anything about it because I just didn't make that effort. A huge misstep, Jesse.
Yep.
Huge misstep as a teenager. But then because of me, because of my actions, when I went back as a high school coach, I'm on my player's ass.
You do this. Yes.
I don't want to go, hey, you know what? You're going to get a full scholarship? You're going to get a full scholarship? I'll keep my mouth shut. A handful of people that have got actual full ride scholarships where they didn't pay a dime. And I played with some ballers. I went back and I served the kids that were like me, like try to give them the best. Some listened, some didn't. It's just like knowing all that knowledge, knowing what it takes to get there. And that's why coaching club ball now that, hey, I'm in a position, I didn't want to leave baseball at all.
Right.
But it's, hey, I need to move forward. I need to do something that's going to help me provide for my family and do all that stuff. And I happened to fall into, like I said, I was very hungry and I just needed a piece of bread, but instead it made me this gourmet cake. Have this, please sit in this chair. That's what I got. That's what I got coming to Feel Verified with. Just a great opportunity here. So for me, it's man, so many different things to learn along the way that got me here.
Yep.
Missteps, learnings, different things that you had to learn, and the lessons you get out of stuff. And because I've been here, there, and everywhere, I get to tell kids like, hey man, there's so much more than here. Like even giving advice that some of my players would come to me about their little boyfriends or girlfriends, or hey, coach, this and that. I'm like, hey man, look, there's a whole world out there.
Right.
Don't worry, you're gonna graduate high school one day, and if you decide to go play baseball in Missouri, guess what? It's a whole different group of people you ain't ever met before, a whole different life. And like me, I can go almost anywhere in this country and I know somebody.
Yeah.
So teaching and learning, making sure kids that come from my neighborhood that think they have everything in San Diego, it's just a small little piece of your life.
That's definitely it. One thing that stands out is what you said was, I don't think this is the way I serve best. You said something like that.
Yeah.
And that, again, that's something that I asked myself, and I didn't always ask myself the question, but when I finally was able to say, you know what, this is how I serve best. And I need to figure out how to do that as many hours in a day as I possibly can. That totally shifted the trajectory of my life. It wasn't about how much money I could make or how much promotions I could get. It was about how can I serve best. And you said the same words, and it's like, yeah, like that's like the secret formula. If you can understand how we serve best and then put our energy towards that, you're not going to get crumbs. You're going to get cake, like you're getting, right? You're going to get some sweet cake with frosting in service to others. Of course, we got to respect ourselves and take care of our bones, but the goal is to help. The goal is to serve. I've been blessed with gifts and talents, and it's my responsibility to use them in service to others. If I don't do that, and I want to be greedy and hide it and keep it and overcharge for it, guess what's going to happen? I ain't going to have a lot of fun doing that sort of stuff.
Yeah.
So you've thrown it out there a few times, the missteps and the learnings. And this one's the backstage pass question, right? You've got a lot of experience. Is there a very significant learning you had from one of them big, bad, stinky missteps?
Hey, yeah, I would say, wow, I had all those things to say and now they just left my head. But I would say the biggest one, which has actually been a strength of mine, but I say it has been a weakness of mine as well.
Okay.
My strength.
Oh yeah, I gotta interrupt the flow just a little bit. Can you hear that music in the background? A little groovy music. Anyhow, this little segment of this interview exists and is only available on the YouTube. That's right, we got a YouTube channel, Learnings and Missteps, check it out. Or you can go to learningsandmissteps.com and find our YouTube channel there. And while you're there, you can also click on become a member to contribute some money, like funds, straight up. I'm just going to say it. 80% of that is going to be donated to the Skilled Trades Alliance, because the Skilled Trades Alliance mission is very much in line with the Learnings and Missteps mission. And we're going to support great things and great people. And you signing up as a patron will contribute to that effort. So we appreciate you deeply for doing that. Also, I don't know if y'all heard or not, just in case you missed it, I'm an author now. Jennifer Lacey and I have co-authored a book. You got to check it out. Lean in Love, 5S Love Letters. It's on the Amazon. The whole goal of that book is to just help one person. And so far we've gotten several people from the No BS tribe, from the L&M family, that have indicated to us that something, at least one little thing in the book, has helped them. And so we've kind of exceeded our goals, but to exceed the goal and continue helping people, that is the ultimate privilege in the world.
So while you're out there on the Amazon, on the YouTube, on the LinkedIn, all the socials, leave us some reviews, leave us some comments, let us know you're out there. I know you're there. I see the statistics, the data, but I don't get to interact with y'all, and that makes me a little bit sad. Anyhow, I'm gonna stop my whining. Appreciate y'all very much. Go to the YouTube to catch this Learning and Misstep Backstage Pass. And here we go, back to the conversation. I'm out there a lot when I go talk to schools and talk to universities and stuff for about careers in the industry or anything. If they'll just give me time, I'm gonna talk that. And I used to always give out my business cards, right? And people ask, now I just put a QR code on the slide deck or whatever. But people are like, man, aren't you afraid? Like, you're giving all these. I was like, no, I'm not afraid. Like, when I say, call me, here's my information, I mean it. Like, what if everybody called? I'm like, that would be a great problem to have.
Yeah.
But the fact is, very few people ever do. Very few people. Like, I'm talking less than 1% will actually get my contact information and move on it in the future. I love the deal. I stole your cheat code, bro. Remember how you sent me your contact? I did it. And this week in New Orleans, we're at the conference and there are a bunch of people. I'm like, here, give me a number. I'll just shoot you my stuff. Super fast, super easy. But the point is, what I've tried to practice now, like I like running a whole bunch. I'm out walking. I'm in my head a lot, especially when I'm running. I'll think of, man, I need to talk to, I wonder how I'm doing. And I'll just text them right then and there. Hey, man, I was thinking about you. What's going on? And hey, girl, what's going on? How's the kids? Whatever it is. Because if I don't act on that, for me, it's an act of self-betrayal.
Mm.
And those actions of self-betrayal pile up and pile up and steal joy from my life. And I'm not okay with that anymore.
Wow. That's a good way of putting all that right there. Self-betrayal. That's what I've been feeling all these years.
Like, I did it to me. I betrayed myself by not taking that action, by letting my fear control. Now, man, you're getting me fired up, bro.
It's the fear of rejection. And then one thing that I almost started seeing was like, are you like, and I did this with me playing ball. Like, I stopped playing ball probably 2 years before I should have gave it up. Like, I really had... I had the juice, Jesse. I had some juice.
Man, what position were you? Were you second shortstop, catcher?
I was a catcher.
You were catcher, okay.
Yeah, defense was my strength. Like, I could hit, but defense was like, hey, this guy's a pro level. You know, wow. So that was my thing. And it's like, I just had to keep working.
Keep building.
Because then I would see guys that missed steps. I see dudes that I was better than. And these dudes kept going for those opportunities and kept making those strides in that realm, and they ended up playing at a decently high level. And there's a couple guys that are still out there doing their thing, and I'm like, man,
yep.
But going back, obviously life has led me in a great direction. I love it. Yep, it's like a misstep that I had, like my shortcomings as a ball player was just not fully believing in myself. Almost afraid of success. Am I afraid to be successful or the rejection part? So it was like the battling, like,
yeah.
Are you afraid to not be good enough? If that's what it is, it's crazy because it was almost like I never had that mentality, and then somehow it grew into me. Mm-hmm. It's like a cancer. And if you don't deal with it and you don't overcome it, like, it'll just get worse. And at some point, I think it became when I coached, when I started realizing my shortcomings more. It started being more like, it's like you put on that different lens, and you're like,
Yes.
Not to tie in relationships again, but it's almost like once you get out of that toxic relationship, you take a step back. You're like, I allowed this to happen?
Yeah, man.
Like, this was going on, man. I was blind. So there's certain things that you realize after. So I think it became when I was on the teaching end of things, when I started realizing my shortcomings as a ball player, and then started realizing where, man, I wish I would have had this help at this age. So I essentially wanted to become the coach that I felt I needed that would have made me that much better. So when it comes to that area, it's just, man, like the things, it's just like the little things that if you just take those leaps, and it's crazy because you look back on my life and I talk about my story, you're like, man, this guy took a bunch of opportunities, but there were so many more that I was just afraid to take.
Yes.
And so I did find different routes and I bounced back from missed steps, but it's like, there's other steps that's like, man, if I didn't miss that step, I wouldn't have missed that step. And I would have missed that one and I would have been there.
I do.
Would be missing steps on me, not me still missing the steps.
Yes.
But I think that's what it goes back to now. And everything that I talked about, how I was like, there's dudes out there, probably coaches, people I know that gave me their numbers, was like, hey man, get in touch with me. And they didn't reach out to me because, hey, he must be fine. He never hit me up.
Yeah, he ain't hungry. That's exactly what I, when I reach out and put myself out there for somebody and they don't go out and respond or take action, I just, grace of God, hey, they ain't that hungry. They got food on the table. Yeah. That's okay. I'm happy for them. And it's going to stay like that, right? Yeah. The hungry people, if you hungry, hell, this my grandmother. You like menudo?
Cool.
So when I was a kid, like I would not eat menudo. I never even tasted it. I just didn't like the way it looked because it got all kinds of stuff in there. Anyways, I was at my grandma's house, my dad's mom. And like, you know how it was. Like you're not inside the house unless you're eating, take a shower, ready to go to bed. The rest of the time, get out there, go play with your cousins, right?
Yeah.
And so we're out there playing, come back in. Grandma, I'm hungry. She said, okay, here's a bowl. Here's everybody. There's menudo. And I looked at her, I said, oh, I don't want menudo. She said, oh, okay, mijo, you're not hungry. Go play. Okay. So I went and played, ran around, come two or three rounds of this. And you know how at the end of the day, you're all red face and your hair's all plastao. And she says, again, third time, she said, well, all right, mijo, let me heat up your menudo. And I'm like, okay. She heats it up, puts on the stove, right? And I start like picking at it. And I'm like, man, that was good. I said, Grandma, why didn't you make me something else earlier? She said, because you weren't hungry. I said, but I was. She said, you know, if you're hungry, you eat. And you didn't want to eat. And guess what you learned? You learned that menudo's pretty good. Damn it, that lesson, bro, it stuck with me forever. If you're hungry, you're gonna eat. If you ain't hungry, you go be peaky. That's all there is to it.
That's the truth, Ruth, right there. Yeah, that's the truth right there. And in this case, in many cases, I was still very hungry, but I was just afraid to ask for food. The food that was already offered to me.
Right. All you got to do is come up with your plate. It's like at the barbecue, right? You just go take your plate.
Hold your spoon. Hold your spoon. Let me serve you your food.
Like, I'm telling you, man. I love it, bro. All right. So I'm excited for your response to the next question. Because you have a servant's heart, right? Like I think you're about breathing life into the community, breathing life into other people. And so with that in mind, you got a baby on the way. Congratulations.
Ooh, girl dad in the house.
Whoa, watch out. What footprint do you intend to leave on the world, my man?
Man. Oof, what footprint do I want to leave in the world? I want to be better than what I am right now. I want to continue to be a better man in all facets of my life. And as well as if I'm a better man for myself, I will be able to help others a lot more than I even help them now.
Yep.
And that's something that I've also learned along the way, where it's like I was helping so much that I wasn't helping myself. And because I wasn't helping myself, I wasn't fully where I needed to be, where I could really help the next person. As well as I really want to serve them. Just continue to be a better man. Matter of fact, Leon Bridges, one of my favorite artists out there from Texas.
All right.
He has a great song called Better Man, but it's obviously it's a different thing. But when I say Better Man, that's the song that's what pops into my head. But yeah, I want to continue to be a better man for myself, and continue to be a learner and always learning, never acting like I know everything. That's one thing I tell my players when I coach high school, college, and now that I'm coaching high schoolers again in select ball, is I don't know everything. I'm never going to act like I do, but I sure as hell know a lot more than you do. But that's the thing, is I'm always learning. I want to continue to learn. I'm never just satisfied with what I am. I may have to get my feet under my ground, learn what I'm learning, and then finally turn on to learn more. But it's always learning. That way you're able to educate. And the more you know, knowledge is power. And as I've gotten older, I really understand that now. Because the more you know, the more you're able to move about things differently. I'm starting to learn stuff about the housing market now. And I'm like, there's so much to it, but it's once you figure it out, it's
good.
Yeah. So I'm still some time away from that. But learning about it, I'm like, man, there's so much to it on how it's not as, sometimes it may not be as, certain things may not be as hard as you may think they are once you look into them. Like, right. Wow, this is really good. I could have done had this 6 hours ago.
I just ate it this morning.
I would have been on my second or third bowl right now. But, and that's what it is, like, just like it is right now. So it's just continuing to learn. And I want to look back. And what I enjoy now is, like, my former ball players, guys that I've helped, I've been the bridge to them. I always tell kids, I'm like, hey, I don't get you the scholarships. I just point you in the right direction. I just show you where you could have an opportunity. This is what's calling for you. There you go. You're the one that earns it. So yep. I love when players hit me back and be like, hey, coach, I really appreciate you doing that for me. Even a kid that joined the military, his parents were really pushing him for college. He's like, coach, I've always just wanted to join the military. I'm like, looking at options where you can join the military and go to school while you're in the military.
Ah, there you go. Yeah.
You satisfy mom and dad. And at the same time, you're going to get yourself into a higher level now.
Yep.
And yeah, matter of fact, he should be being close to graduating. I think coming up actually this year might be his graduating for his college, but he's in the Navy. So he's doing his thing. But it's like having kids come back and like, just appreciate like, hey, I remember this one. And sometimes I'm feeling old. Where like some of my players from when I was coaching 9 years ago now, damn coach, I remember you told me this and that. I'm like, I'm kind of like, you sure that was me? Yeah. And I'm like, damn, I guess I did say that. I'm glad I gave you that advice. It's continuing to have that. And it's continuing to build that on because I feel like that's me giving back to the community and giving back to the people that pretty much like, how I say it, it's like, showing gratitude to the people that helped me get the places I'm at now, showing them gratitude by helping someone else. And guess what? That guy is going to remember how I used to help him. He's going to help someone else. And
that's it.
Hopefully that makes the world a better place. But as far as what I want to be remembered for and you know, how I want to impact, like it's just continue to do what I'm doing now, but just on a way better level than I am now.
Boom. So that's what I heard a guy say. He said, I don't want to be the best. I always want to just be getting better. He said, because if I'm the best, that means I've arrived and I've reached the end and I don't want to get there. I got to keep growing. I got to keep learning. I got to keep getting better. But I knew you were going to bring it, brother. So who do you want to give a shout out to? I know you threw some names out there. Who else you want to give a shout out to?
Oh, shoot. Just my family. Yeah, my fiance, Crystal. I love you, girl. Gianna, my daughter. Then my one on the way right now, her name's going to be Yaslina, so little Yazzy, shout her. No, my mom's, Alma Sanchez, my brother's Geeky, Ruben. I want to give just a quick shout out to my boy Sergio Cruz. He came down here and did some work for us.
All right.
Did some concrete stuff. He has his own little flooring. He has his own like concrete company he's got going on, JLC Concrete. So, but yeah, just a shout out to them. And just a big shout out to you, Jesse. Thank you for having me on. And of course, a big shout out to my company, Feel Verified, for allowing me the studio space I got right now. all my peoples here, Feel Verified. Much love.
That's cool, my man. Thank you. Did I not tell you that man has got one engaging personality? I think maybe back in the day, if he and I got together, and maybe we're out and about, we could have got ourselves into some trouble in a good way, good, healthy trouble. He's an amazing dude. I got fired up when I interviewed him and when I was editing. I'm like, man, this dude's just straight up cool. Somehow he even got me to talk about the Menudo story, which is one of my favorite stories, but I don't think I've ever said it on the air. Anyhow, we always want to wrap up the show by showing some love to the L&M family members. They go out of their way to give us some feedback, to let us know what they're thinking and how this content is affecting them. And so we got another Amazon review on the Amazon on that other book, my second first book, Lean in Love, 5S Love Letters. Michael says, valuable insights on industry relationships. And yes, sir, 100%. We got to give credit to the No BS tribe who showed up and contributed during the 5S live streams. We were able to harness a lot of experience, a lot of wisdom, a lot of truths, a lot of vulnerability that everybody contributed to the conversation during the live streams.
and then transform that into the book. So Michael, appreciate you going out of your way, putting in that extra time to go in there, giving us the 5 stars and then dropping us a sweet comment. I appreciate that. We're batting 1,000 right now on them Amazon reviews with all 5-star reviews. So thank you all for your support, the comments, the posts, the pictures that y'all are posting on the LinkedIn and on the Facebook, on the social media, showing some love for the book. We really appreciate that. Be cool, and we'll talk at you next time. Peace. Oh my goodness. You're either driving down the road or just so enthralled with this whole podcast that you went all the way down to the very, 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 very end of it. And we appreciate you. And just, we're going to take this as an indication of your dedication. So we got a little special request of you, a call to action, because everybody tells us that like you need to have a call to action. So here's the call to action. Be kind to yourself. Go out there and share a smile with someone.